Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in giving a warm welcome to His Excellency Mark Rutte, Prime Minister of the Netherlands. Mr. Tharman, Shanmugaratnam, Singapore's Deputy Prime Minister and Coordinating Minister for Economic and Social Policies, and Professor Wang Gangwu, Chairman, IC's Board of Trustees. Minister Mark Rutte, Deputy Prime Minister Tharman Shanmugaratnam, Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon and a very warm welcome to the 39th Singapore Lecture. ISIS Yusof Ishak Institute is privileged to host this lecture entitled The Netherlands, Singapore, Our Regions, Our World, Connecting Our Common Future. This lecture will be delivered by Prime Minister Mark Rutte of the Netherlands. I now have the pleasure of inviting the Deputy Prime Minister of Singapore, Mr. Tharman Shanmugaratnam, to deliver his opening remarks, introduce our distinguished speaker, and chair the proceedings. DPM, sir, please.
His Excellency Mark Rutte, Prime Minister of the Netherlands, Minister for Environment and Water Resources, Masako Zulkifli, and my cabinet colleagues, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, a very warm welcome to the 39th Singapore Lecture. It is my pleasure to welcome Prime Minister Mark Rutte on his first official visit to Singapore. The Singapore Lecture has been privileged in the past to have welcomed two of Mr. Rutte's predecessors, former Prime Minister Ruud Lubbers, who delivered the 11th Singapore Lecture on International Economic Developments in 1991, and former Prime Minister Jan Balkananda, who gave the 30th Singapore Lecture on New Global Partnerships in 2009. Today, Prime Minister Rutte carries on the strong tradition, reflecting the high regard we have always held for the Netherlands. The Netherlands and Singapore share long-standing and deep bonds, which were developed well before our independence in 1965. The Dutch have also left a strong and positive imprint on modern-day Singapore. We all know how Dutch economist Albert Vincenus, with his vice and his close collaboration with our first generation of leaders, was invaluable in helping Singapore find a role for itself in the world economy quickly after independence. Today, we have a robust economic partnership with the Netherlands. It is our third largest European trading partner and fifth largest global investor, with over 1,300 Dutch companies based in Singapore. We also feel connected to each other because Singapore and the Netherlands are globally minded and practical minded countries. Being connected to the world has always been part of our history and our beliefs. As pioneers of ASEAN and the European Union, respectively, we are firm advocates of regional integration. We also share a deep commitment to open economies as the foundation for global prosperity and security. In this regard, the EU-Singapore Free Trade Agreement, when ratified, will strengthen our economic links. We also look forward to the EU-ASEAN Comprehensive Air Transport Agreement, which will improve our connectivity and people-to-people ties. On the international stage, the Netherlands is an active promoter of international peace and legal order, as evidenced in the Dutch support of counter-piracy efforts in the Gulf of Aden, and its active contributions to UN peacekeeping efforts in conflict zones such as Afghanistan, Mali, and South Sudan. In this regard, I would like to congratulate the Netherlands on its successful bid as a non-permanent member of the United Nations Security Council in 2018. Looking forward, we face an uncertain and complex regional and global environment. In Europe, Brexit has added to the already challenging agenda. As the 60th anniversary of the signing of the Treaty of Rome approaches in 2017, the European project is facing enhanced challenge domestically in several of its member states. Strong leadership and active policies to help those who lose out because of technological change or global competition are needed to reinvigorate inclusive growth and preserve faith in internationalism. But before we hear the views of our distinguished speaker, a brief introduction. Prime Minister Rutte began his political career as State Secretary for Social Affairs and Employment in 2002 and was appointed State Secretary for Education, Culture and Science in 2004. Before that, he had over 10 years of experience in the private sector, including at Dutch multinational Unilever. When he was elected in 2010, at the age of 43, he was the Netherlands' second youngest prime minister. Mr. Rutte is well known for his pragmatism, optimism, and energy, qualities he displayed when the Netherlands assumed the presidency of the European Council during the first half of this year, when the EU had to deal with some of its biggest challenges, in particular the migrant crisis and the immediate outcome of the Brexit referendum. Domestically, he has displayed a similar steady hand and clear vision, especially in guiding the Dutch economy out from the global financial crisis to its current position of strength and stability. Without further ado, let me invite Prime Minister Rutte to deliver the 39th Singapore Lecture on the Netherlands, Singapore, our regions, our world, connecting our common future. Thank you.
Your Excellency Deputy Prime Minister Tharman, Shanmugaratnam, Professor Wang Ganbu, Your Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen, students, Vice Prime Minister, thank you so much for your very kind introduction. As the elections are approaching, I think I shall hire you for my party meetings next year. You can do all the introductions, this was very kind. First of all, thank you for giving me the opportunity to speak to you here today. And I'd also like to thank my host, Prime Minister Lee, for inviting me to visit your beautiful country. 2015 was a notable year for Singapore. You celebrated 50 years of independence with a parade of 11,000 people, fireworks, and 600,000 roses made from recycled plastic bags. For me, those roses are typical of Singapore, both creative and responsible. Even on a public holiday, you uphold the principles of the circular economy. On March 23rd of the same year, your country was plunged into mourning by the death of Mr. Lee Kuan Yew. He is greatly missed. In the words of his son and your Prime Minister, Lee Hsien Loong, to many Singaporeans, and indeed others too, Lee Kuan Yew was Singapore. Lee Kuan Yew's life ran parallel with Singapore's transformation from a colony to one of the best performing countries in the world. He was the architect of the Republic. In his memoirs, he noted, "We had to create a new kind of economy, try new methods and schemes never tried before anywhere else in the world, because there was no other country like Singapore." His vision and dedication helped turn Singapore into an economic superpower. With its low unemployment rate, high GDP, low levels of corruption, and well-maintained public spaces, Singapore has rightly been described as the little city that could, and the envy of the world. So, what is your secret? What makes us so jealous when we look at Singapore? I expect you know better than I do. But if I were to hazard a guess, I would say it's all down to education. Singaporeans make Singapore what it is. And this country invests in its people. You value your human capital. Thanks to ICs and other research and education institutions, Singapore is a world-class knowledge hub. Its universities are among the best in Asia and even the world. But it all starts with primary schools and teachers. And they too are among the world's best. Your focus on education is all part of your focus on the future, on the next generations, on the world in 2020, 2030, and even 2050. Indeed, your unofficial motto is staying ahead of the curve. You ask, what will the city look like in the future? How will they live and work together? You don't say, let's worry about that later, because today we sow the seeds of tomorrow's world. Take those recycled plastic bags, or your urban environment, where breathtaking architecture goes hand in hand with sustainability. Lee Kuan Yew wrote that there was no other country like Singapore, and that is still true today. But let me ask you to picture a map of the world. It will show that Singapore and the Netherlands are thousands of kilometers apart, at opposite ends of the giant Eurasian landmass. From the Netherlands, Singapore is one of the most distant places you can get to by land. And yet, our similarities are striking. Let me start with the obvious ones. Singapore and the Netherlands are both small in terms of size, but big in terms of influence. Not without pride, you call yourselves the little red dot. And I can see why. Singapore may only be a dot on the map, but its influence is out of all proportion to its geographical size. For our part, the Netherlands also punches above its weight. We are slightly bigger than a dot, but not by much. And if you look at the World Economic Forum's ranking of the most competitive economies, you will find Singapore in second place and the Netherlands at number 4. And we beat the Germans last year. Both countries also make the top 10 in the Global Innovation Index. And what about the Where to be Born Index? Here too, the Netherlands and Singapore are both in the top 10. So, how can we explain this? It's partly to do with our strategic coastal locations. Singapore is the springboard to the big economies of China and Southeast Asia. The Netherlands is the gateway to a continent of over 500 million consumers who have money to spend. So it's hardly surprising that trade is in our DNA. With airports serving millions of passengers a year and two of the biggest and busiest ports in the world, Singapore and the Netherlands have evolved into logistical hubs. And your ties with the port of Rotterdam are excellent. A coastal location, obviously, has many benefits, but also has a disadvantage. If the polar ice caps melt, both Singapore and the Netherlands are at risk of flooding. But as the late Dutch football legend Johan Cruyff was fond of saying, every disadvantage has an advantage. Keeping back the water has made us creative. It has made us think in terms of opportunities instead of problems. If we don't have enough room, we make space by turning water into land. We have created polders, and all the same is now taking place at Pulau Tukong. Or by building upwards instead of outwards. This may help explain why Lee Kuan Yew and the Dutchman Dr. Albert Winsemius got on so well when they met in 1960. They recognized something in each other. They were both pragmatic, optimistic and forward-looking. Winsemius came to Singapore in 1960 as an economic advisor. His involvement with your society and your country lasted until 1984. In that time, he played an important role in industrialization and the development of the port. Albert Winsemius Lane in the west of Singapore bears witness to the lasting impression he made. And this was a two-way process. An article in the Straits Times with the telling headline, advisor turned friend, noted that Vincenius became so committed to Singapore's cause that even members of his own family started calling him a Singaporean. Albert Vincenius advocated an open-door policy. For him, the success of small industrialized nations like the Netherlands and Singapore depended on free trade and an open economy. Lee Kuan Yew agreed wholeheartedly with Vincenius on this point. We have to stand up for those shared values of free trade, openness and optimism. The Netherlands and Singapore, particularly these days, must form a united front. There was applause here in my text, but if you agree. We really have to form this united front. And particularly today. Because at a time when support for protectionism and nationalism is on the rise, when the British want to leave the EU, and when unrest is growing on the edges of our continents, it is crucial that we think hard about the future, about what matters to us. What will the world indeed look like in 2020, 2030, and even 2050? How can we ensure a safe and prosperous future for our people? We have, to be honest, no easy answers to these questions. The trend towards ever-growing free trade, which has brought our countries great prosperity, is now meeting with resistance. In Europe, the Brexit vote has created uncertainty. After Ireland and Malta, the Netherlands has the highest percentage of GDP derived from goods and services exported to the UK. Both Singapore and the Netherlands will take a hit due to our positions in the global value chain. And the Netherlands is losing an ally in the European Union. For now, so far, little has changed. The UK is still an EU member and still subject to EU rules. It's up now to Britain to take the first step. But the Brexit vote does mean that we in the EU have to consider the way forward from here. And the bottom line is this. The EU post-Brexit will still number 27 member states that are fully committed to working for jobs, economic growth and the safety of their people. So it may not be business as usual, but run a referendum in member states will not endanger the Union as a whole. The point of the European Union is to enable us to tackle problems and take opportunities that transcend nation states. Member states each have their own interests, but generally we all want the same thing. We all want growth and jobs. We all want to promote Europe's stability and security. We all want to work on dealing with the refugee problem. So these common interests make up the EU's sphere of activity. They are the basis for its support and legitimacy. During my country's presidency of the EU earlier this year, I saw once again what a difference the EU can make. How working together produces results that individual member states could never achieve working alone. The Dutch economy is firmly anchored at the heart of the European Union. The Netherlands has the euro, it's part of the Schengen area, and it is one of the six Union's founding members. The EU single market is crucial to our trade position. For a trading nation like mine, with an international mindset, membership of the European Union is vital. It means the Netherlands remains safe and a reliable location for foreign investment and a gateway to major European markets served by excellent infrastructure and logistics. But it is important that the EU continues looking beyond its own borders. We have to stay committed to securing free trade agreements so that the world stays connected. Signing CETA with Canada was an important step. The EU-Singapore Free Trade Agreement is now before the European Court of Justice. It's high time this agreement entered into force. I appreciate the patience Singapore has shown, and the Netherlands stands ready to ratify at the earliest opportunity. Because of our locations and our size, our two countries place a high value on a well-functioning international legal order. The Netherlands plays an important role here with The Hague as the legal capital of the world. And the eminent lawyer, Professor Tommy Koch, has made a major contribution to the development of international maritime law, whose origins go back to a treatise by the Dutch jurist Hugo Grotius, The Free Sea. The UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, on which Koch worked so hard, has become the standard point of reference for determining the rights and duties of nations in relation to the sea. Ladies and gentlemen, our era will be defined by how we respond to the forces ranged against globalization and how we respond to technological change. The consensus behind free trade agreements is perhaps yesterday's reality. And uncertainty and resistance to agreements may be the situation of today. But the solution for tomorrow is definitely cooperation, cooperation and cooperation. We must not retreat into our own countries, behind walls, barriers and borders. We need to go out into the world. We need to embrace cooperation and show what it can accomplish. Knowledge and innovation are the engines of future economic growth and the answer to tomorrow's questions. How can we protect our nations from a rising sea level? How can we continue to provide the world's growing population with sufficient drinking water, food and energy? How can we deal with demographic aging and climate change? We, the Netherlands and Singapore, have the resources to come up with the answers to these questions. We can innovate together. We both have dynamic and creative economies in which our universities, the private sector and government work together. And we have a solid basis to build on. The Netherlands is one of Singapore's main trading partners within the European Union. And Singapore is by far the Netherlands' biggest trading and investment partner in the ASEAN region. No fewer than 1,300 Dutch companies have established a presence in Singapore, in part as a springboard to the fledgling ASEAN economic community, for which they have high expectations. They want to be part of ASEAN's continued development. Our tradition of cooperation and knowledge sharing goes back to Albert Vincenius and Lee Kuan Yew. Since then, Singapore and the Netherlands have continued working together in the sectors that are so important for our countries. Water management, biomedicine, transport, and also urban infrastructure. One example is NUS Deltares, the National University of Singapore working together with Deltares. It is the knowledge alliance between these two wonderful institutions. And Deltares, as you know, is the Dutch Water Research Institute. It pulls expertise on water management in both countries so that we can reach new heights. In this way, we are helping each other to keep water in check where necessary and to use water where we can. Cyberspace is another area which presents both opportunities and dangers. The Netherlands and Singapore are among the most connected societies on the planet, but it also makes us vulnerable. A cyber attack could have a major impact on our countries and regions and even on the world as a whole. That's why in recent years, public, private and academic partners from Singapore and the Netherlands have been working together to keep our societies cyber resilient. Urban infrastructure is another subject that is familiar to both our countries. How do we use limited space as efficiently as possible? Climate change adds a second challenge. How can we build in a way that causes minimal harm to the planet? Singapore is leading the way here. Your city in a garden is now full of green marked buildings. And I'm honored you named this system after me, by the way. Green Mark Buildings. My name's Mark, so. They meet the strictest requirements for sustainability. In the Netherlands, the Dutch Sustainable Growth Coalition is demonstrating business leadership by anchoring sustainability in business models and practices. And my government aims to have a fully fledged circular economy in place by 2050. Businesses, public authorities, and research institutions are working together towards this goal. Mr. Lee Kuan Yew once said, "What I fear is complacency. When things always become better, people tend to want more for less work." Wise words, and his warning is especially relevant today. We cannot afford to sit back and take our achievements for granted, as global trends have shown once again. We have to stand up for what we believe in: free trade, an open economy, democracy, and the rule of law. We must not only safeguard the legacy of Lee Kuan Yew and Albert Vinsemius, but also update it for the present day by promoting prosperity and quality of life while staying mindful of the planet's limited resources. And we must do so by drawing on all the courage, creativity, and cooperative spirit we can muster. These are the foundations on which today's Singapore and the Netherlands are built. These are the foundations for our success. Later today, I will be talking to young people from the Dutch startups who are part of the Startup Academy. Something about the Singaporean mindset drew them here to Singapore to make connections. They are now planting the seeds which will determine what Singapore and the Netherlands will look like in 2020, 2030 and beyond. They are connecting us to our common future. And that means we all can look forward to that future with a lot of confidence. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor, Prime Minister Rutte, for that breath of optimism and energy that you're so well known for. And admirable clarity and succinctness as well. Thank you very much. I now open the floor for questions. Not speeches, but just questions. Yes, please.
Thank you. My name is Mola. I'm Danish, but live in Singapore. At the ICS where I work. First of all, Mr. Prime Minister, a big thank you for underlining the virtues of the European Union and how indispensable it is for the European nations. There are too few voices saying that truth today. Now the question. You talked about the protectionism, nationalism, Brexit, and you said that we are moving into a new world order emerging to, let's say, 2040. And you skirted a little bit by saying you could not predict which kind of world order it would be. But I will not let you off the hook completely. What kind of world order do you want?
Well, what I would love to have in the future is a clear focus on free trade, on the values which made us great, our societies in Europe, in America, in Asia, and to build on those foundations. But at the same time, we have to be very open and honest. In our societies, we see this in many countries in Europe, also in the Netherlands. We have seen it probably in the American elections last November. This month of November, that somehow the traditional political parties, also my party, so the parties in the center of the political spectrum, I'm of the Dutch Liberal Party, so I'm right of center, and in the Netherlands we have also more centrist parties and parties left of center, people felt let down. And this is not because of the Muslim population or because of the refugees. I think it is because they felt let down by the traditional political parties in their anxieties and their worries about the future. And when we talk about free trade, when we talk about globalization, there's also, of course, the flip side of that, and that is that people can become worried, what does it mean for me, my job, etc. And we have to present the case, and the case is this, that we cannot build strong societies and strong growing economies if we do not embrace free trade, openness, and outward looking. But at the same time, we have to be very clear that this does not mean that there will not be more jobs. No, because we are doing this, this will create more jobs. I'll give you one example. I was visiting a manufacturer in the south of Limburg in the Netherlands, which is producing for BMW, cars for BMW. And this factory had only 1,100 workers, and now they have 5,000. In the meantime, they also have 1,200 robots. So I said in a speech the other day, it's not because of the 1,200 robots that the amount of jobs grew from 1,100 to 5,000. It is thanks to the 1,200 robots that this factory now has 5,000 jobs instead of 1,100. So we have to present that case for openness, for an international outlook, for free trade much clearer. And I'm absolutely convinced if we can do that, whilst at the same time recognizing worries people have, and making clear that we want to deal with those worries, that we want to take care of those worries, that we are there to protect the people, then I'm absolutely convinced that people will come back to these traditional values and move away from the more extreme parties. So my argument is not with the voters. My argument is not even with the parties to the extreme. My argument is with my own party and the other traditional parties who have not in time addressed these issues.
Next question. Yes, Professor Tomiko.
Prime Minister, thank you very much for your inspiring lecture and for your very kind reference to the work that we did in the UN conference on the law of the sea. I had very eminent Dutch colleagues, Professor Rip Hagen, yeah. Professor Alfred Soens, and many others. My question for you is this. What lessons have you learned from Brexit and from the recent election in the United States? And how can we resist the prevailing wind in parts of Europe and in America, which is blowing against free trade and globalization and towards a narrow-minded nationalism?
Very good question, and yes, well, I salute you. I had the opportunity to shake hands with you earlier today, and indeed the work you did, and I'm very happy that some of us could help there has been of great importance. And then back to your question, and it goes back to the first question of the Danish professor. It has to do with how are we going to deal with societal tensions, how are we going to deal with the fact that people feel left out, that they feel not to be in control of their own lives. And some of us, we can talk about globalization and openness and international free trade. But again, if we do not make absolutely clear that it is thanks to international free trade that we are able to create all these jobs. I mean, take Singapore. This country has almost no unemployment. And that is not despite free trade, it is thanks to free trade. It's absolutely clear. The case is here to make. And the same for the Netherlands. We have 2.1 million jobs. We have 10 million jobs in the Netherlands in total. And of those 10 million jobs, 2.1 million are directly linked to our international trade position. 70% of which within the European Union and 30% with the rest of the world, like with Singapore. You are our most important trading partner in Asia, Singapore. Being small, but not small, maybe in size, but not in importance, as Hans de Boer, our chair of the Dutch Employers Organization, would argue. So again, we have to make clear that by upholding these values, that we can create an ongoing flow of growth, job creation, that also people above 45, 50, 55 years old can find new jobs, etc. And that if we retreat behind the walls of our own countries, that we have to pay a price. And you can now see the price in the UK. The UK with Brexit is now in a constitutional crisis. Scotland, Northern Ireland, Wales wanted to leave. It is in a monetary crisis. The pound has slipped. And it is in a financial, it is in an economic crisis. I mean, the growth has now been cut almost by half for 2017 by Hammond yesterday, the minister of the United Kingdom. He was saying literally, yes, but we are still ahead of Italy and France. I thought, well, this is a benchmark. I mean, ahead of France and Italy, I would never have heard a finance minister of the UK compare himself with finance or Italy. With France or Italy, he should compare himself with other countries. And the Netherlands is now growing on 2.5% this year. Next year, we hope the same, maybe a little bit less, 2.2%, 2.1%. So almost twice the rate of the United Kingdom. And this is directly thanks to the Brexit. So this is the price you pay. And I believe that nationalism is not a bad thing. I mean, I'm a nationalist. I'm chauvinistic. I love the Netherlands. I will always stand up for my country and protect what stands for, etc. But that does not mean, I mean, your Prime Minister, Mr. Lee, he is very chauvinistic about Singapore, I hope, and as I know him, he is. But that doesn't mean that this cannot go hand in hand with having an open mind and being pro-free trade and pro-openness, etc. This all goes hand in hand. But we have to make that case much more clearly. We as politicians are there to think about the future. We need a clear view of the future, but at the same time, we also are there to protect people. And we can protect people best by having this openness, having free trade. So we need more of it. But you also need to be we have to engage in a dialogue. Why we think this is helping to create future economic growth.
Thank you. Professor Chan Heng Chi.
Thank you, Prime Minister Rutte. My question follows from what the other two gentlemen have posed, but it's a different angle. You've talked of loss of jobs and people, you know, being left out, and this creates a major problem, you know, in Brexit, in the United States, and Europe is facing the same problem. That's one basket. But in the same basket, but of a different kind, is a problem of diversity. I think Europe, Britain, the United States are all facing the arrival of new immigrants, and diversity is a problem. Multiculturalism, is said in Europe to be dead. Chancellor Merkel, in fact, said multiculturalism is dead. And I think it's a problem in Britain, it's a problem in France, I believe in Australia, even down south here. They've said that multiculturalism is an issue. How do you see the problem? Mm-hmm. In Singapore, we believe multiculturalism must be curated to succeed. DPM Shanmugaratnam said, you cannot deal with it with an invisible hand. Multiculturalism must be guided must have a guided hand. And so I invite your comments, because Europe faces this problem.
Yes, I'm convinced that the problem in Europe is not with the Islam or with the refugees. I think the problem is how the political elite is reacting to the fact that we have a rise of refugees. That we last year, second half last year, the Netherlands would typically each year have 15,000-20,000 refugees per year. The population accepts this. This is what we should do as a rich nation. We should be open to people who are running for devastation, for war, etc. But last year we had 60,000, three times what we would have normally, particularly from Syria. And then the numbers become too high, and people feel that society cannot cope with these high numbers. So the first thing we needed to do, and we have been successful, is to bring down the numbers again by striking a agreement with Turkey and investing in the capacity in Turkey to build reception capacity for refugees from Syria. That was the first thing we needed to do. But this was not the crucial point. The crucial issue is this, that people feel that the men and women leading the countries in Western, in Europe and elsewhere, have not been clear enough about our values when people came from outside. For example, in the Netherlands we think it is absolutely normal and acceptable that two men or two women walk hands in hands on every street and every neighborhood. This is something we find of high value. We find it totally acceptable that a woman can reach any position in the country. We had 100 years of queens, so anyway it was clear that she could. And now we have a temporary man, but he has a daughter, and so after him we will have a queen again. So for a woman to reach every position in society is absolute. But then, when people come from outside with a different cultural background, you have to be very clear on these values. What is your history of your country? What have we achieved together? You are here now. We want you to be successful. But also, please understand, yes, you can have your faith. Absolutely. We have freedom of religion, of course. But we also have certain societal values, and we have not been clear enough what these are. And then you get tensions, and then some people are saying, well, maybe these two men should not walk hand in hand on every street in every neighborhood. I say, no, they should. Of course, we will never compromise on this. And people coming to the Netherlands have to accept that this is our value. And if they do not accept it, they have to go again. I mean, I don't want them to stay. This is not because I'm anti-Islam. No, I'm not, to the contrary. But I am anti trying to compromise on these core values of the Netherlands. And this, I think, is where we made the mistake. So, and then people are saying, people then start to listen to parties who are saying the problem is with the number of refugees, the problem is with Islam. But here's the root cause. And I always bring it back to the ruling parties and their task and what they did wrong. And I was part of that. I mean, I'm not blaming others. I'm in politics now for 12 years, so I'm part of some of the mistakes we made. And we try now to correct it. And we have to do it very quickly and fast, and I see a lot of consensus amongst most parties to do this, with keeping our role as being a place where refugees can find shelter and where freedom of religion is upheld as a principle.
Okay, next question. Yes, gentleman in front.
I hope you have a loud voice.
Prime Minister Rutte, it was finally very nice to see you in person. I did my PhD in Netherlands, and I'm doing my
postdoc
Leiden University. Leiden University.
You know, ladies and gentlemen, I am an alumni of the Leiden University, so this is a good guy. He made the right choice.
And so was the Queen. And now I'm doing my postdoctorate here, but I'm actually Turkish. I was born in Istanbul. So I firsthand was able to see in Netherlands for the duration of 5 years the situation. Actually, you just became prime minister when I moved there. And from what I saw, especially with the rise of the Party for Freedom, with Geert Wilders, with the rise of nationality, was that there was this miscommunication, because the people that were voting for this nationalistic party were never in contact with anyone but Dutch. They came from such neighborhoods. And also that there was this discrimination between the Dutch Turks and the Dutch Dutch, whereas I've been telling my friends that these people have been here for two generations and they haven't been completely absorbed the Dutch ideals that you are putting it out. So my question is, how can you communicate this to people that you get rid of this closed system with the nationalistic parties on the rise? And also, I want to point out that the people that are affected by this globalization and decide to vote for nationalistic parties are actually at the opposite side of the spectrum with the trade jobs, because these people are in the working class individuals that see their jobs going to these countries where their own country, the Dutch government, is making deals with. So all of a sudden there was such a decline. And then they see their life in, their economy in danger. So this is not due to them seeing a loss in the overall output of the economy, but that they see it from a personal point of view. I don't have a job, I don't earn money, I want something to change, and I want something out of the system.
Thank you. Well, basically two questions. First, on the second one, on losing out on globalization, on free trade. Yes, there will be people, because of free trade, because of inter-globalization, who lose a job, who lose their job. But we have to uphold the belief that thanks to free trade and thanks to a global outlook, in the end, at the end of the day, the pie is bigger for all of us. There will be more jobs, more prosperity, and if we don't do this, at least in the Netherlands, if we would completely close off the country, we would lose 2.1 million jobs. And so yes, you might have individual people where things work out in a way they don't find acceptable, and then we have need to help. But at a macro level, it's clear that we cannot cut 2.1 million jobs if you would basically close off the country. And then secondly, on integration, we had many people with a Moroccan and Turkish background coming to the Netherlands in the late 70s because many Dutch people were not willing to do some of the work, and we asked people from particularly Morocco or Turkey, some of them from the Dutch Antilles, to come to the Netherlands and do this work. And they stayed, they had children and grandchildren, and many of them are doing very well. Started businesses, some of my friends with a Moroccan background in the highest levels of McKinsey. But still, at the same time, you are absolutely right, many are still not doing very well. I'm teaching myself, not for money, but just as a hobby, for 2 hours a week in a migrant school in The Hague. And in that school, it is a school for children between, young people between 13 and 16 years old, secondary education, a vocational, sort of pre-vocational training courses and a school. And these children are all from a neighborhood where there's almost no traditional Dutch family living anymore. And in that school, I think there are one or two traditional Dutch children, and most of them are from Eastern Europe. And most of them have a third or fourth generation, as a Moroccan, Turkish, Dutch Antilles background. And you're absolutely right, it is difficult to get that integration going. I believe that if we can keep the numbers of new refugees coming to the Netherlands down to an acceptable level, as I said, which we would traditionally have, and at the same time, these young people I'm teaching there, I get very positive about, because they're not worried about globalization. They just want to have a job. They're thinking about working in industry or in the health sector or whatever they're going to do. But they all make plans. And at the end of the day, I believe that the next generation will be more successful. I'm quite optimistic about that. But here we made a mistake by taking so many people in without thinking through what it means, that if they stay and get children and the families grow bigger and the next generation, the third generation comes along, what it means in terms of how this will mix with the rest of society. We have not thought that through in the late 70s and early 80s. That was a mistake, and luckily we have no no-go areas like you have in some other parts of Europe. The police can still police everywhere, and in that sense integration is better off. We are better off than many other countries, but still a lot to do. And so your point is well made.
Next question, gentleman over there.
Thank you, sir. My name is Tharman from the ASEAN Study Center, so I'm a good guy. We are promoting the study of community building in ASEAN. And next year, ASEAN will be celebrating, just like you, 50th anniversary of our founding. Thank you for sharing your optimism with us. My question is, ASEAN has been observing and learning from the European experience, and lately we have observed that you have some difficulties with Brexit. Before that, you have euro problem in Greece, and even the migration problem. What can ASEAN learn from the remaining 27 EU government in coping with Brexit? This will be a very important lesson, because are we seeing the limit of European integration?
Well, I think the most crucial thing is that somehow the European Union was seen as a project which is marching forward in history. And that if you still love the Netherlands or Germany, that you are a bit something of the past. And that you should be a true European. And that is not working. I feel this myself. I don't feel European, I feel Dutch. I feel from being from The Hague, a particular part of the country, or the Netherlands, but I don't feel I'm a European. I have no identity with Europe. I feel an identity with the Netherlands. And Europe for me is a very pragmatic and practical organization to work together. I don't think anybody in Singapore will ever feel ASEAN, or anybody in Indonesia will say, I'm ASEAN. No, I'm from Indonesia, or even from Java, or from Singapore, whatever part of the ASEAN organization. So one is don't present it like a sort of super state. And this was, I think, what we have done too long with the European Union. This is would move into a sort of super state. And if you would still think that the individual member states had their role, that you were a bit something of the past. And people then started to get upset and rebel against that that vision. So we have changed that, luckily. And for me, that was very crucial. Secondly, don't make it into a big bureaucracy. Come to Brussels, I show you the buildings, the Commission, 30,000 people working there, the Council of Europe, the European Council and the Council and the European Parliament, and they're all fine people working there. Nobody hates other people. They're all there to do the best of their ability, but there are too many of them. And that creates bureaucracy. You get all these people looking for a party. I mean, not for a little party, but they want to do some real stuff. And they tend to work on things which should be left to the member states. So I'm very happy that the Juncker Commission now has a clear program. And the program is to bring back power to the member states and focus on only three essentials, which is a strong economy, a strong internal market, a strong currency for the Eurozone, and protecting our outer borders. Those are the three things this commission is focusing on. All the rest is left to the member states. Education, healthcare, how you deal with people who are out of work, pensions, etc. That is all to the member states. Defense is to NATO and the member states. So, and that is crucial. But when it is seen as a project of the bureaucracy and the politicians who want to become big, which becomes bigger and bigger and bigger, I think it will fail. At least that's what we did wrong. And I'm not an expert on Asia, but I cannot imagine, I was in Semarang 2 days ago, that someone in Semarang feels I'm an ASEAN. No, I'm from Semarang. I'm from Mid-Java. I'm from Java. I'm from Indonesia. And there probably it ends. And he will not say I'm from ASEAN. And that's not a problem. ASEAN is a pragmatic project, which makes total sense, and which you can easily explain, I think, why you're doing it.
Well, I'm afraid I have to...
I'm too long on my
answers. No, not at all. I must say...
I want to be complete.
And I'm sure the audience agrees with me on this, but Prime Minister Rutte, you are someone whose mix of optimism and practicality makes you a very persuasive leader. I thank you once again for honouring us with your presence and for delivering the first time.
Thank you, Prime Minister Rutte, and thank you, PPM, sir. Ladies and gentlemen, Professor Wang Gangwu, Chairman IC's Board of Trustees, will now present Prime Minister Rutte with a memento, a painting by Singapore's foremost batik painter, Mr. Sarkasi Syed. Professor Wang, please. Thank you, Prof. Wang, and thank you, DPM, sir.
Oh.
Excellencies, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, we have now come to the end of the 39th Singapore Lecture. May I please ask that you remain at your seats while Prime Minister Rutte, Deputy Prime Minister Shanmugaratnam, and accompanying guests take their leave.